Macmillan Audio presents Greenwild, The World Behind the Door by Pari Thomson, narrated for you by Sophia Nomvete. To Adam and Fariba. Prologue. The sandstorm arrived like a leopard on the hunt, fast and very wild. Daisy held her breath as sand glittered through the air. It was biting her cheeks in bright, painful dashes, but she couldn't take her eyes off the storm. This way! Ma had to shout over the wind. Now! A great zigzag of lightning struck the top of the nearest dune and Daisy leapt back, mouth suddenly dry with fear. She could see scarves of sand rising like ghosts in the wind, the flash of her own white knuckles, the grim expression on Ma's face. The sand made the air flicker, and then the storm was on them, outracing them over the ridges of the desert until there was sand in Daisy's teeth and between her eyelashes, and she couldn't see much further than her own fingers. After that, several things happened very quickly. Ma skidded to her knees and pressed one hand into a dip in the dunes. The air went still, and a ring of bright white orchids rippled out around them like water. Daisy's mouth fell open in astonishment and rapidly filled with sand. She was still spitting furiously when a fresh squall swept in and blinded her. But an afterimage of the orchids stayed burned onto the inside of her eyelids. They had been the snowy colour of cotton socks, fat petals and thickly veined with silver, and sending out threads of light that streamed together like a pale, shining dome over their heads. Inside the dome, the sudden silence rang loud in her ears, broken only by their panting breaths. Daisy crouched low beside Ma, trying desperately to see past the grit in her eyes. She thought she could make out the blurred ring of orchids and, through the curtain of silver threads, the sandstorm raging silently through the red night. By the time Daisy's eyes had recovered, the worst of the storm was over. The dome, if it had ever existed, was gone. "We got lucky," said Ma the next morning, when the wind had cleared and the air was cool and crystalline in the pale blue light. "That valley between the dunes, it kept us safe." "But," said Daisy, "I thought I saw flowers, white flowers." "Flowers in the desert," said Ma. She laughed and ruffled Daisy's sand-crusted hair. "My rascal, whatever will you think of next?" Chapter 1. 6 months later. Daisy Thistledown didn't have a home in the ordinary sense of the word, but there was something about London that always made her feel particularly happy. They had arrived that morning from Rome, where Ma had been writing an article about some disreputable politicians, and they'd had to leave rather quickly after it was published. Here in London, the December sky was a dazzling blue above the rooftops, and there was a glittering, festive feeling in the air. They were in town for a meeting with Ma's new editor at the High Herald, a man called Mr. Craven, who had a brilliant reputation and a fondness for toffees, which he kept in a jar on his desk. Mr. Craven had only been at the High Herald for 3 months, since just after Daisy's 11th birthday, but people already spoke about him as if he was someone extraordinary. He was very tall and charming, with pale green eyes and a mouth that smiled on one side. He'd spent many years in the field, but had retired from active service after an unfortunate incident involving an angry hippopotamus. "Rather too exciting," he explained, as he ushered them in, smiling lopsidedly and laughing in a way that showed his teeth. As well as toffees, Mr. Craven's desk also boasted a gleaming computer screen, a hostile-looking cactus, and a framed photograph of himself shaking hands with the Prime Minister. "A brilliant woman," he said to Daisy, adjusting the gold cufflinks of his crisp white shirt and revealing a cluster of 5 moles on his left wrist. They were arranged in a stretched-out W shape, that reminded Daisy of the constellation Cassiopeia. Quite brilliant. She's going to take this country places, I can tell you. She called me just the other day to say. He broke off, staring at something. Why, what an unusual necklace, Mrs. Thistledown. Wherever did you find it? Just an old trinket, said Ma, looking self-conscious, and tucked away the daisy-shaped pendant on its fine gold chain. Now, Mr. Craven, about my next trip. These attacks in the Amazon rainforest. For a moment, Daisy caught an odd expression in Craven's pale eyes, as if he was staring at a great cinema screen that no one else could see. Then he blinked and smiled, and she wondered if she'd imagined it. Ah, yes, he said smoothly. Peru, you mentioned that you were thinking about covering the story. Tell me. Daisy slunk into the corridor, opened up the creased book she kept in her rucksack for occasions like these, and settled down to wait. Daisy was good at waiting. It was necessary, if you had a mother as extraordinary as hers. Layla Thistledown was a journalist and travelled all over the world chasing stories. Daisy loved this expression, chasing stories. She liked to imagine Ma waving a butterfly net through the air and scooping up flighty headlines and unruly articles, news about kings and anarchists, barrel bombs and jewel thieves, rigged elections and rare monkeys with golden eyes. Good journalism is like electricity, Ma would say when she was asked for the secret of her success. It should make you sit up and yelp. And she would grin, the grin that made her look more like a mischievous 10-year-old than an internationally renowned reporter. Daisy went everywhere with Ma, and at moments like this she felt like a partner in her world-changing enterprise, the sidekick in Ma's diamond-bright conjuring act. Ma would shake the stories from their net and write them up on a travel-scratched laptop that clattered and battered its way through the night as Daisy tried to sleep. The stories were sent back to the newsroom of the High Herald to appear in thousands upon thousands of papers all over the country each day. They were read by bespectacled doctors with black briefcases and lawyers in immaculate suits, by apple sellers and jazz musicians, avant-garde artists and mustachioed diplomats, by curious schoolchildren and feather-boa nightclub dancers. Everyone read Layla Thistledown's articles in the Herald. People always looked surprised when they discovered that Layla Thistledown had a daughter. Then they would be charmed. Why, she's just like you, they would say, laughing. A little Layla doll. Daisy would scowl, pulling down her eyebrows in a way she hoped looked forbidding. Everyone always assumed that because she looked like Ma on the outside, she must be the same sort of person on the inside as well, wild and adventurous and brave. But Daisy didn't feel like any of those things. She was quiet and watchful and not brave at all. Now, she heard Ma's laugh from inside Craven's office and the sounds of the meeting coming to an end. She closed her book, ready to go. This was her life. Ma's headlong energy, the momentum that took them from city to city, from continent to continent, rootless, dauntless, and always chasing the next big story. Daisy's place was with Ma, and she was, Daisy told herself firmly, perfectly content. She poked her head around the door of Craven's office just as Ma was gathering her bag to leave. Stay in touch, Craven was saying, shuffling a large stack of papers. And don't take any unnecessary risks. A page slipped from his hands and floated to the floor at Daisy's feet. It was a map, the sort of thing you can't help bending down to stare at, beautifully detailed, covered in spiky handwriting, and printed with a single bold word along its top edge. Peru. Thank you, Daisy, said Craven, his voice suddenly steely. He leaned forward and took the map from her fingers, and in a moment it had vanished into a drawer in his desk. His green eyes glinted, and he nodded at Ma. Safe travels, Mrs. Thistledown. After the meeting, they walked out into the bustling streets that ran along the river, where Christmas lights shone like diamond bracelets and the rolling Thames lapped against the stone walls of the embankment. The afternoon was dusky and cold and filled with parakeets flashing across the sky like bright green needles through blue silk. The first time Daisy had spotted them, she had been astonished. But now she knew that London was full of the birds, and had been for years. They perched jauntily on lampposts and posed in the treetops like tropical Christmas decorations. According to Ma, some people thought the parakeets had escaped from London Zoo and multiplied in the wild. Others said they'd vanished from a film set. Either way, the city's frosty streets were teeming with glamorous green birds. It made Daisy feel as if anything was possible, as if all manner of unexpected and extraordinary things might be just around the corner. Ma checked the time on her phone, then turned and looked at Daisy with bright eyes. How about a quick trip to Kew? Chapter 2. An hour later, they were walking through the curling iron gates of Ma's favourite place in London. Royal Botanic Gardens, Kew, read the sign at the entrance. Welcome to the most biodiverse place on Earth. The gardens were full of booted and mittened visitors, and the famous glass houses were misted with condensation where their tropical warmth met the chilly air. Outside, the trees were bare and the flower beds empty, but inside the palm house, the air was rich and heavy, like a sauna. Daisy breathed deeply and sighed. She never got tired of the earthy way it smelled. All around them were swaying palms with leaves as big as tablecloths and looped vines that twisted around the lacy Victorian ironwork of the glass house. It was like standing in an indoor rainforest. Look, said Ma. She pointed at a five-petaled flower like a pink starburst. Madagascar periwinkles. They're used to make cancer medicines. Isn't that amazing? Daisy grinned. Ma knew everything there was to know about plants. And this palm tree, said Ma, is called a suicide palm because it only flowers once when it's 50 years old and then it dies. Ma reached out a finger and touched its bark. Daisy could have sworn that the great palm waved a leafy frond, but then she blinked and shook herself. It was nothing more than a coil of warm air passing through the glass house. She tipped her face upwards, noticing a spray of monkey brush vines, a cluster of yellow flowers like ear trumpets, and a bunch of tiny pink bananas that grew upwards instead of down. Ma had been bringing her to Kew since she was old enough to crawl, and the sheer variety and oddity of the greenery always made her fingertips tingle. Daisy had always loved plants, even if they did sometimes behave in strange ways around her. Once she had been so bored while waiting for Ma to finish an interview with a Sherpa. They'd been on a mountain crag in the Tibetan Himalayas at the time. That she'd gone wandering off by herself and hadn't seen the edge until she'd slipped over it. The fall should have killed her, but an outcrop of laurel trees had burst into wild leaf and shot their branches out sideways, catching her mid-plummet. Another time she had been playing football in the street. This was the April they'd spent in Delhi during the last elections. And she'd seen a thick-necked boy called Bruce trip up the smallest girl on the other team 3 times in a row. He was a bully. She'd seen him do it before. And she had felt something boil over inside her, like a pan of water left too long on the stove. Then suddenly Bruce had been screaming, writhing on the pavement, his skin covered in big puffy red welts. Poison ivy. She heard the doctor whisper as the boy was taken away, limping. Goodness knows how it grew through the pavement like that. And then there was the time Ma had taken her to dinner with a very grand lady in Paris, who had served them fresh lobsters and boasted about how her chef boiled them alive. The polished cherrywood table at which they'd been sitting had sort of shrugged. And the next minute, their dishes and bowls were soaring through the air, trailing dramatic arcs of lobster bisque behind them. Ma had marched Daisy out in double quick time while their translator strewed abject apologies in their wake. Today, though, was a perfectly ordinary day. Pulling a leaf out of her untidy braid, Daisy headed deeper into the glasshouse, barely noticing the commotion as a passing tourist turned to look at Ma and walked straight into a palm tree. But then she saw something unexpected out of the corner of her eye. She thought at first that it was another vine, but vines are not black and white and furry. Without pausing to think, Daisy darted after it, just as the thing whipped out of sight round the nearest corner. She followed, hurrying, ducking under a low-hanging branch, which seemed to lift itself a few centimetres out of her way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.